Imagine you buy an apple tree that produces 100 apples a year for $100. Over the next decade, you work hard on growing that tree while buying another $60 of fertilizers and collecting your apples every year. Finally, in year 10, you trim 60% of that tree and sell it to a bigger farmer for $1,300 while still enjoying a lovely apple tree that produces 150 apples a year. In just 10 years, you would have reimbursed 13 times your initial investment while now owning a tree for free that's 50% larger than it initially was. What a happy investor you would be, right? Well, this story is not a fiction. The investor is SKion Water, the tree is Ovivo, and all those multiples just materialized with the carve-out of Ovivo's microelectronics division to Ecolab for $1.8 billion. And more than just a game changer, this transaction first confirms that the water investment thesis is very profitable if you play it right. Second, sets a new anchor for valuations and positions in the water food chain. And third, it's just the emerged part of a much larger iceberg that's reshaping the water sector's structure. Want to get to the bottom of this to understand what's in it for you if you're an investor, a water entrepreneur, or a water executive? Let's get into it. The Ovivo trajectory in 5 minutes. Let's start with a bit of history to set the context. Ovivo was born as La Perrière et Véro, an engineering firm mostly specializing in pulp and paper, based out of Trois-Rivières, Quebec. The company rapidly grew through multiple acquisitions and went public on the Montreal Stock Exchange in 1986, while revolving around three divisions that materialized in the late 90s: process, pulp and paper, and water. The next major pivot happened in 2007 when the group La Perrière et Véro, this will sound familiar, carved out its process group to FL Smith for $950 million. Then 7 years later, the group sold its original pulp and paper business for $65 million, moved its headquarters to Montreal, and rebranded as Ovivo. Their water revenue at the time was slightly above $300 million, with about 1,000 employees and the ambition, according to their then newly appointed CEO Marc Barbeau, still CEO today, to reach a $1 billion revenue within 5 years. But what the newly created Ovivo may not have realized immediately is that these numbers placed them in a unique spot in the market, as Reinhard Hübner told me.
When we looked at North America a few years ago, there was hardly any company in the range of, say, 75 to 200 million turnover. There was the small ones, and then there was a few very big ones.
Now, Reinhard making that realization wasn't a coincidence. He was looking at North America with a clear idea in his head. He had been appointed as investment manager by Susan Klatten, the heir of the BMW empire, with a mandate to build a water company, what would become SKion Water. By 2016, he had already shopped around and acquired 7 water companies, but he was still missing a platform to buy and build upon, and Ovivo becoming a water pure play was just too perfect of a target to be ignored.
We were actually lucky with Ovivo that they were in the range of 200-300 million and that we could take them from the stock market.
To do so, SKion Water teamed up with the Caisse des dépôts et de placement du Québec to take Ovivo private, SKion Water holding 70% of the shares and CDPQ the other 30%. The transaction closed for $185 million at an 11 times multiple of Ovivo's EBITDA and 31 times its earnings. This will matter later. Once this done, Reinhard, who had joined the Ovivo board, applied its strategy to build upon the platform.
You really have to do small buy and build. We buy companies with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 million in turnover. Not always, but we do that. We don't do it because we want to get big. We do it when it's a fit.
This means that not all of the SKion Water acquisitions went to Ovivo, the group having other arms, but still, over the next years, it welcomed Filterbox in 2018, Varec Biogas in 2019, Alar Engineering in 2020, Sembrain first as a minority stake, then as a full acquisition in 2021 and 2022, Wastec Controls and Engineering in 2022 also, and the most recent tuck-in, E2 Metrics in 2024.
Absolutely spectacular design, spared no expense.
This triggered the Ovivo Group to grow to 18 countries with 1,500 employees as of this year. They incorporated over 12 legacy brands, opened a silicon carbide membrane production in Texas, but maybe even more importantly, their electronics division boomed to become one of the market leaders in the semiconductor ultra-pure water amidst the recent explosive growth in fabs and chips manufacturing around the globe, and particularly in North America. This is probably what, in turn, made them too perfect of a target to be ignored by the few big ones. Ecolab probably realized that they would be much better armed in the AI chips race with Ovivo's semiconductor division on board. And this all leads us to this August, when Ecolab and SKion Water announced the carve-out of Ovivo's electronics division to Ecolab for $1.8 billion in cash, hence transferring 900 employees and $500 million of expected yearly revenue to the water sector's giant, potentially enabling Ecolab to more than double its own revenue in that market vertical. Some more metrics about that deal: it values Ovivo's electronic division at 3.6 times its revenue and an estimated 18 to 24 times its EBITDA. Meanwhile, Ovivo doesn't vanish. It still stays under SKion Water's ownership with three divisions: a municipal slash industrial slash PFAS division, an energy division, and the sembrain slash silicon carbide membrane division. This entity retains 600 employees, a yearly revenue I would estimate at $400 million, and most of the tuck-in acquisitions, even if that is not clearly stated by both Ecolab and SKion Water's communications, as I would only expect Wastech Systems to be carried over to Ecolab. So, if we do the maths, SKion acquired Ovivo for $142 million, then proceeded to tuck-in acquisitions for a total, which is, to be clear, my personal estimate, of $90 million, which makes for a total of about $230 million, then sold its largest division, yes, but still only one division, to Ecolab for $1.8 billion while retaining a $400 million a year entity. Say you don't apply the carve-out 3.6x multiple to the remaining entity and only value it at a one-time revenue multiple, that makes for a total enterprise value prior to the liquidity event of $2.2 billion. And there you have it, a documented 10x multiple for a partial private equity, partial growth stage water investor, and all of that in under 10 years. Which leads us to number two, what this confirms in terms of water investment. Now, if we zoom out a bit and look at the implications of that deal, the first thing is obviously that the multiples I just laid out confirm a lot of the hypothesis we have in water investment, starting by, yes, it is profitable.
No shit, Sherlock.
In fact, the Ovivo deal and multiple is only the latest of a string of proof points that have been popping out since the beginning of the year. If you recall, I had Henry Charabé on this microphone some years ago to discuss Morgan Stanley's acquisition of Seven Seas that he's leading as a CEO. Well, this May, Morgan Stanley sold Seven Seas to EQT just 5 years in for the double of the price they had acquired it. Then, earlier this year, I made a piece on LG Chem's exit from what once was Nano H2O, which they sold to Glenwood. Well, they held on to Nano H2O for 11 years and sold at a 5x multiple this June. Third example, and I give you that, a bit harder to trace, 3M acquired Kuno in 2005 for $1.35 billion, then spun out Solventum in 2024, notably including what once was Kuno. Solventum then sold that purification and filtration business unit to Thermo Fisher this February for $4.1 billion, which, with a lot of asterisks, I really give you that, makes for a 3x multiple over a little under 20 years. One more example I covered more in depth in my newsletter this time. You may want to subscribe. The link is in the description.
You shameless craven, you.
Aris Water Solution was founded in 2016 as Solaris Water Midstream. It received early backing from Trilantic and Yorktown, two PE investors, who owned 52% of the company at the time of its IPO in 2021. Well, this June, Western Midstream Partners acquired it for an enterprise value of $2 billion, which, according to my rough estimates, would make for a 4 to 5x multiple for our two PE investors in under a decade. And last example, this January, Eversource sold Aquarian Water Company to a newly created quasi-public entity of the state of Connecticut for $2.4 billion. Well, Eversource had acquired it in 2017 for $1.7 billion, which makes for a 1.4 multiple, which sure is lower than our other examples here, but there's a story in the story here, because prior to that, Aquarian had been under Macquarie's ownership from 2007 to 2017, which bought it for $860 million and sold it to Eversource, if you follow, for $1.7 billion, hence making a 2x multiple in a decade. But more than just proving that a water investment is profitable, I think this reveals a second layer. To be profitable in water investment endeavors, you need financial and water skills. Yes, SKion needed Susan Clatton's patient money, but also Reinhard Hübner and Dirk Brusis' brain, some of the best ones in the water world, if you ask me. Along the same lines, Morgan Stanley had a water veteran with Henry Charabé, and the list goes on. Another key element that stands out from that list is that pure plays perform much better than conglomerates. Spin a pure play out of a multidimensional company such as 3M or LG, and it's the recipe for added value, and so far, I'm speaking of water pure plays, but something that will be interesting to watch is if water is still too broad of a definition for a pure play, as we now have an Ovivo A that looks into semiconductors and an Ovivo B that caters to more traditional municipal and industrial fields. Will the two perform even better separately? It will be interesting to watch. Now, the mathematician I used to be also can't ignore here the demonstration by contradiction offered by Dupont. Dupont is still a conglomerate, which, as we see from these examples, tends to be a bad idea for the company's value. Now, Dupont wanted to spin out its water arm, which would have gone along the lines of this list. It would have been probably a $5 billion transaction, the largest on the list, and I know two water companies that were in the deal room wanting it to happen. But instead, Dupont decided water was so valuable and high growth right now that it rather divested another arm and hold onto its water division, because water is profitable and you'd rather streamline your activities around it than sell it off like GE did less than a decade ago and must still make nightmares of when they see that they sold GE Water to Suez for an enterprise value of $3.4 billion in 2017, while CDPQ sold its remaining shares to Veolia for an enterprise value of $5.83 billion this May at a 72% premium. So, bottom line, water is a profitable investment and as a driving seat investment, not as a passenger of other deal components. Yes, we were many to be convinced of this for years, but now we have substantiated proof that numerically goes beyond outliers. Which leads us to number three, anchoring the values in the water food chain. Because now there is, I believe, one more very important financial dimension here that will matter for earlier stage water investors and water entrepreneurs, and it has to do with valuations. I'm speaking of water food chain here because we can build the following schematic. Let me try to be clear here. A few very large water behemoths, Xylem, Veolia, Ecolab, Veralto, and a few others, sit on top of the food chain. You can never exclude that one of them snaps and decides to take over its neighbor, like Veolia did for Suez not so long ago, but they mostly hunt on the next level in the food chain. One of the key reasons why they keep an appetite for hunting is that they get rewarded for it by the stock market. Indeed, there is more money in investment funds that wants to get invested in publicly traded water companies than there are publicly traded water companies of a sufficient size, and as a result, you see PE ratios like Xylem, Veralto, or Badger Meter. So they hunt on the next level, as Xylem did with Evoqua not so long ago, and as Ecolab just did with Ovivo's electronics division. As a result, the companies on that second level have a strong incentive to shop on the third level to build the platforms that in turn would make them the perfect targets for the big guys. Let me put platforms as a third level. Those are all the deals I just quoted minutes ago. These are reshuffling, consolidation, or tuck-in plays of the second level, shopping at the third level. But this is today also where it stops. As Reinhard Hübner highlighted in the quote I gave you a moment ago, there are very few companies on that third level in that $200 to $500 million revenue range. According to my own estimates, which I have to acknowledge here are very subjective, there are fewer than 100 companies in the world and in that revenue range, which would also make for potential platform plays. And even if they were all open to an acquisition, which they're not all independent at all, as clever PE plays sometimes already sneaked in some millions to secure a first serve, like what Cerberus Capital Management did with Aquatech earlier this year. So there is potentially a bet here on building fourth level companies into third level ones to become targets for second level ones trying to get attractive to first level players. Do you follow my logic? I know I have a sick brain, sorry. To understand the implications of that cascade, let's start from the top. Disclaimer, this is not absolute science, it's a mental model, please take it for what it is. When a first level company acquires a second level one, it does it for about $2 billion if we take a median value from recent examples. Let's consider SKion's 10x multiple as an outlier that anchors the top of the envelope and the 1.4x from Eversource as the bottom of the envelope. This gives us a give or take 2.5x median here, which means that the second to third level transaction must have been for somewhere around $800 million. So you can expect to sell your mid-sized water company to a second level player or PE platform for about $800 million. Now still, schematically, growing to that company size will probably require raising money up to a Series C, right? If we consider a 20% dilution factor over each round, we can backwards estimate how much money we can slash should slash would theoretically raise, what's needed for our investors and for everyone involved. This would make for a $53 million Series C, a $17 million Series B, a $5 million Series A, and a $1.5 million seed round. Honestly, even though this is a pure mental model, it sounds like in line with what we see in the real world, right? Now, from the investor perspective, it would promise a 3x return on investment for Series C investors by the time of the exit, a 7.5 multiple for Series B1, 21x for Series A, and 52x for seed business angels. Okay, I hear you. This is probably where it slightly disconnects from reality, but one can dream, right? Now, the reason why I do that exercise is that our sector overwhelmingly sees seeds and Series A, not so much activity past those, meaning that the ladder from the fifth level to the fourth works fine, but the one from the fourth to the third is still quite weak, which was understandable as long as the upper stairs of the ladder also seemed loose. But now that we see that they are more and more ironclad, I would believe that it strongly de-risks the investment thesis for late-stage investors stepping in B2C rounds and able to finance building up the third layer. This is probably why we see XPV Water Partners building a platform at exactly that spot with their announcement of Opus Water in June, and this is probably what SKion Water will now do again with the treasure chest of their Ovivo Electronics carve-out. I wouldn't be surprised either to see early-stage investors such as Burnt Island Ventures further climbing that ladder by launching yet another fund after their growth stage one last year to cater to these Series B and C steps, while I totally see a SKion Water going down one step to meet them at that stage. And the reason I would envision that immediate future is actually rooted in the following evidence. Number four, the rise of PE-backed platforms. And I don't need this one anymore, so let me make some space. Because yes, I might be incredibly clever and you may want to attest to this by booping the like button, but still, if I spot a trend, the superior brains at work in PE funds probably spotted it as well. Or they are maybe simply subscribed to this channel, in which case, hi, come signal yourself in the comments. And indeed, private equity has gone on an absolute shopping spree in the water sector over the past few years, and they are actively contributing to a fundamental reshaping of the industry. Just look at the numbers. Amber Infrastructure took H2O Innovation private while acquiring stakes in multiple water tech companies. KKR built Axius Water as their acquisition vehicle, gobbling up six companies in 4 years. And SKion Water, which I just addressed seconds ago, continues consolidating US utilities while building technology platforms. These three examples are absolutely not isolated. Over 20 major PE firms, including Blackstone, Bain Capital, Morgan Stanley Infrastructure, and Equity, have made significant water moves recently beyond the ones we already discussed today. There really is a growing pattern. PE firms don't buy assets, they build platforms, do bolt-on acquisitions with the aim to create the billion-dollar water portfolios I described as level 2 earlier today. And interestingly, they're also shopping from each other, with Frontenac buying Serum for SKion Water and Newterra from Angelino Group. Overall, the least I can say is that the velocity is accelerating. And if you need a step-by-step concrete example of this in action, I already alluded to it, but the sales by LG Chem of its water solutions division to Glenwood Private Equity for $700 million at an interesting 16x EBITDA multiple is another great example of that transformation in motion, in line with our SKion Water / Ovivo case study for today. If you want to know more about that story, have a look here and you'll get to discover how this deal connects to a decade-old story involving a Nobel Prize, space technology, and why even failed water innovations can deliver 15% yearly returns. Plus, you'll have confirmation of what I said today about water pure plays with the story of a dropping share after the sale, my best guesses of Glenwood's next moves, and potential token investments. Check it out If you do, I'll see you there. And one way or the other, I'll see you next time.